My name is Dr. Abhilasha, and I'll be giving you a small talk on diagnostic tests and investigations in periodontics. So I'll be covering this particular topic under these headings: introduction, need for investigation, classification, chairside investigation, laboratory investigation, molecular diagnosis, recent trends, conclusion, and preference. So moving on to introduction, diagnosis is defined as a correct determination, discriminative estimation, and logical appraisal of conditions found during examination as evidenced by distinctive marks, signs, and characteristics of disease. Laboratory studies are extension of physical examination in which the tissue, blood, urine, or other specimens are obtained from the patient, and then it is subjected to different types of investigations or examinations. And whatever information is obtained from that helps in identifying the nature of the disease and also leads to a final diagnosis. So evidence shows that case history and clinical examinations usually reveal most, or you can say all, of the clinical relevant data. But there always remains a need to confirm our clinical impression, because the investigation supplements rather than replace other methods for gathering information. And also, it is a very known fact that sometimes the patient might not be aware of certain underlying conditions which we come up to know first time during any type of dental investigation. So we'll see what are the different needs for which we have to do investigation. So first is to confirm our any type of clinical diagnosis. Whatever clinical diagnosis we make, we need to confirm that diagnosis in order to have a written evidence report with us. Secondly, it can also help us in guiding the patient through the treatment aspect and also explaining them about the prognosis of the treatment and the particular disease structure. Further, it also helps in determining a baseline data and comparing our treatment before the treatment and treatment outcomes before the treatment and after the treatment. And above all, it provides information for medical legal consultation. Coming to the classification, there are different ways of classifying the investigation, and first one is on the basis of where the investigation is done. So it can be chair side or laboratory. Chair side, in case it is done besides the chair, on the dental chair, when the patient is lying on the dental chair, and any investigation done there, it is considered as chairside investigation. And lab investigation, which is highly specific and sensitive. Based on specificity and sensitivity, so before explaining these tests, I would like to first clear these two terms, specificity and sensitivity. So 100% sensitivity means giving a true positive value, while 100% specificity means giving a true negative value. For example, if I have a particular disease and I undergo any type of test which is 100% sensitive and it gives a positive result, means it is definitely positive, means it's 100% confirmed that I have that particular disease. But if it gives a negative result, then it is not 100% confirmed that I don't have the disease. Meanwhile, if I undergo any test which is 100% specific, then if that test gives a positive value for the disease or positive result for the disease, then it is not 100% confirmed that I do have the disease. But if that 100% specific test gives a negative value, it is totally confirmed that I don't have the disease. So 100% sensitive gives true positive value, while 100% specificity gives true negative value. So on the basis of that, we have a screening test and diagnostic test. Screening test is 100% sensitive, which is mainly useful in large size populations. And the diagnostic test, which is 100% specific and mainly used for individual diagnosis. So on the basis of hospital lab services, if we collect any sample and send to the laboratory for analysis, on basis of that, what type of lab we have sent for the analysis, it is classified as hematological, microbiological, biochemistry, immunology, histopathology, and cytopathology. Also, on the basis of frequency of dental use, what type of investigation we mostly use and what we rarely use, on the basis of that, investigations have been classified as frequently used, where we have all the blood investigations and then blood sugar investigations, then occasionally done, which is disturbance for bones, if any test is done, then ESR, urine analysis, and rarely ordered are mostly the enzyme testing or the bilirubin and creatinine estimation. Now, coming to chairside investigation, there are several chairside investigation ways for different types of diseases in the dentistry, but I'll be focusing mostly on the periodontal disease. So, moving on to that, we have different types of investigation. That is, first is periodontal probe, then non-periodontal probe, telemeters, chairside kit, and radiograph. Coming to periodontal probe, as we all know, it is the first instrument which we use intraorally on any patient to see what is the clinical condition and most widely used diagnostic tool. Probing depth is measured from the free gingival sulcus to the depth of the probable crevice. Now, before moving on to different types of periodontal probe, I would like to show you all how to do probing, because it is very important to know the correct way of doing a probing, since it gives the correct knowledge of the nature of the disease or the nature of the periodontium. So consider this as the mandible of the patient and this red one as the gingiva. This is the graduated Williams periodontal probe, and I'll be using this to show how we do probing. So we have two types of probing. One is walking the probe, another is running the probe. So walking the probe is mainly done when we have to check the depth of the sulcus. So consider this as the margin, gingival margin, this part as the gingival margin. The probe should always be done used parallel to the tooth. It should never be at an angulation like this, this, or this. It should always be parallel to the long axis of the tooth. Because if we go at an angulation, there can be reason that we might land up into the embrasure and we get a wrong result. So it should be walked. Now we have six surfaces to check for the sulcus depth, and these are the distobuccal, buccal, mediobuccal, then I hope it is clear. We have distolingual, lingual, and mediolingual. And in all the cases, the probe should be parallel, like this. It should be parallel to the tooth surface. Now, this is walking the probe when we do mostly for the depth of the surface. Another one we have running the probe. Running the probe, we do it, we put the probe in the sulcus area and then we gently run the probe around it like this. This is mainly done for knowing the bleeding on probing. So these are the two ways we use the periodontal probing. Now the longitudinal measurement of clinical attachment loss or probing depth is a gold standard for recording any changes in the periodontal status. So there have been different generations of probe which have come to ease our way of determining the correct depth of the sulcus. So first generation, these are the manual probes or the conventional probes that do not there is no control on the probing force, because the manual dexterity varies from person to person and it is not suited for automatic data collection, but it is the most widely used, and till now we mostly prefer using these type of probes. Next is second generation probe, a study by Tipta et al. And Hunter in 1994 showed that the minimum force which is needed to probe a pocket is 30 gram and to probe any type of ocean defect is 50 gram. So on the basis of this very result, they came to form or they made a new probe which is called pressure sensitive probe, which was allowed for improved standardization of probing. An example is constant pressure probe, and this is a picture which shows how this probe looks. Moving on to third generation probe, it is automated probe. It is mainly, there is no examination bias in such type of probe, and example is Toronto probe, Florida probe, Inter probe, and Foster-Miller probe. This is that probe which is mainly put in the surface area, and the recordings are seen on the monitor. Coming to fourth generation probe has never been much in the clinical use, and it is still considered to be under development. While fifth generation probe is the one which utilizes the functions of the fourth generation and are non-invasive, and they have three-dimensional probing system, and the only fifth generation probe we have is ultrasonographic probe, which looks something like this, which sends the ultrasound beam and helps in determining the depth of the periodontal pocket. Now coming to non-periodontal probe, these are those that helps in determination of other aspects of the periodontium, around the periodontium. First, we have detector. It mainly helps in calculus detection, and it works on the resonance vibration after of ultrasonic treatment or autofluorescence irritation, which is caused by the laser. Next, we have periotemp probe. It works on the gingival temperature around the tooth, and a study by Hafazi et al. In 1992 have shown the correlation between clinical attachment loss and the temperature around the tooth. And they say that wherever there is a higher temperature, they have more chances of clinical attachment loss in the future. So this is a way of predicting how in future the periodontium is going to respond to particular disease. Next is tooth mobility. And this is also utilizes instrument for the tooth mobility. So there is no manual instrumentation around the tooth. This probe is called periotest, which this part of the periotest strikes on the tooth surface, and it records the mobility in terms of periotest unit. Next is helimeter. Helimeter is mainly the machine. It's a type of machine which measures the level of sulfide gas, and then it helps in evaluation of the halitosis level of the particular patient. But there are certain drawbacks to this, that the most common sulfide gas which is determined for halitosis, that is mercaptan, is not easily recorded with the help of this. And also it is very sensitive to alcohol. So a person should not have had the consumption of alcohol before doing this test. Also, they should not have used any type of mouthwash which contains alcohol at least 12 hours before the test. Now coming to some of the chairside kits, we have microbiological, biochemical and genetic test kits. In microbiological kit, we have OmniGen, which these are a type of DNA probe system which helps in determining the subgingival bacteria. So a paper, a subgingival plaque is obtained on a sample of paper, and then this is put in this container, which helps in determining the type of organisms which is present. Next is EvaluCyte. It is a diagnostic kit that is based on a novel membrane-based enzyme immunoassay, and it mainly determines three important periodontopathogens, that is AA, actinomycetin comitans, then P. gingivalis and Porphyromonas intermedius. So a paper point, this paper point is put in the subgingival area, and then it will be collected in a vial like this, which will be subject to the assay. And we get the results within 5 minutes. Next is periscan, which is used for bacterial 15 like proteases. It mainly works by detecting the activity of this particular enzyme. Periodiagnostic, it is a real-time PCR, means it we can show the patient. The results are seen visually. There will be a visual scene for the results, and it can be shown to the patient that what is the condition of that particular area, and it also says about total amount of bacterial load and the progression of the disease accordingly. Next, we have biochemical test kit. In biochemical, first is PerioGuard, which uses paper point GCS samples and calorimetric detection, mainly used for aspartate transaminase enzyme. Then we have PocketWorks, similarly, but it is used for an enzyme called aspartate aminotransferase. PerioCheck. PerioCheck is mainly helpful in the determination of presence of certain enzymes like collagenase. And why we need to know this enzyme is because this enzyme is involved in the collagen breakdown. So, presence of this particular enzyme can give us the idea about the progression of the disease or the important aspect of the periodontal disease. Next is Perio 2000, which is designed to display the sulfide level digitally, and various pathogenic microorganisms produce sulfates, leading to elevated levels of volatile sulfide compounds. And since these volatile sulfide compounds can directly degrade periodontal structures, so they may aggravate periodontitis, and also their evaluation can indicate the subgingival microbial load. Moving on to genetic test kit. Till now, we have only one genetic test kit available for determining the periodontal disease progression, that is periodontal susceptibility test. It mainly works on the detection of interleukin 1 and interleukin 1 beta gene. It also helps in identifying different genotypes of interleukin, which is very much involved in the disease progression of in the periodontal disease progression, and it is associated with diverse inflammatory responses to identify subjects at risk for severe periodontal disease even before the age of 60. Moving on to radiographs, there have been different types of dental radiographs available for detection of alveolar bone loss, but the major disadvantage of is that it needs at least 2 millimeters of bone loss. The initial bone loss is not detected on the radiograph, the conventional radiograph, because it can only be seen once the bone loss is more than 2 millimeters. So they are very specific but lack sensitivity. Different conventional radiographs which we have are periapical radiograph, mainly for seeing the root part, the root apex of the tooth and the palpation area. Then biting radiograph for visualizing interproximal surfaces of both the maxilla and the mandible at a time. And the panoramic radiograph, also known as OPG, which gives overall view of the oral cavity. In advanced radiographs, we moved on from the conventional to advanced, where we started using digital radiography, in which we use a sensor that is kept inside the oral cavity, and we take the X-ray and put that sensor in the monitor, which gives the X-ray, and then we can change the contrast. The advantage of this is that we can change the contrast and focus at a particular point, and also the radiation doses reduce to 1/3. subtraction radiography. Subtraction radiography was introduced in dentistry in 1980, and it mainly works on the concept of elimination. That is, first we take an X-ray of before the treatment of that particular area, like in here, there is a vertical bone loss. So we take a pre-operative X-ray. Then after the periodontal therapy, we take a post-operative X-ray and we eliminate the images which is not of diagnostic value, and then we get the amount of bone gain which has occurred during the treatment. So that's the name. That is how, why is the name is subtraction radiography. Next, the most recent and very a big boom to the dentistry in case of radiography is cone beam computed tomography. Till now we had only two dimensional view. Even with the digital radiography, whatever we had before CBCT, we had only two dimensional view of the structure. With CBCT, a great renovation came and we got a way to see all the areas of the tooth. We can see all the 3D images of the oral cavity, and it helps in determining a good treatment after seeing the determining a good diagnosis and then proceeding with a good treatment with the help of CBCT. This is how the software looks like, and we can see, we can cut that particular section and see in detail all the surfaces of that area. Now moving on to laboratory investigation, we have first is hematological investigation, where we send blood samples for different investigations that can be for the red blood cell count or hemoglobin count or bleeding time. Capillary fragility test. Capillary fragility test we do most of the time for the screening test for the scurvy also. Then clotting time. Before starting any type of surgical therapy, we should be having these tests done in order to see the bleeding and the coagulation time for the patient and to avoid any type of complications during and after the treatment. Prothrombin time. Prothrombin time, it is the time required for clotting of saturated plasma after addition of the calcium and tissue plasmid. Normally, it is 11 to 14 seconds. And nowadays, it is mainly taken as a ratio between the, as a ratio in terms of INR, that is the internationalized normalized ratio, which is a ratio of prothrombin time to the prothrombin normal value. So normally INR is 1. It is mainly helpful in patients who are on anticoagulants. So normal INR is 1, and anything more than 1.5 is considered abnormal INR. And this is the value for different dental treatment, the safe line, borderline, and the adjustment values of the INR. Moving on to biochemistry, it mainly deals with investigation of metabolic abnormalities of the disease, of the body in disease. And in this, the investigation which is very important in dentistry is the glucose estimation, the fasting blood glucose level. Normally it is 70 to 90 milligram per deciliter. In random, 110 to 130, and postprandial, it is around 140. Glycated hemoglobin. Now, they say that random blood sugar gives only a small picture of the glucose level of the blood. It can vary anytime. The a minute before the test, it could be a lot, and even after the test, it can vary. Like it varies, it doesn't remain constant for longer time. So in order to get a bigger picture, we have something called glycated hemoglobin, which we call it as HbA1c. Now, this HbA1c gives the definitive value of blood sugar control for 2 to 3 months. The reason behind this is the hemoglobin is attached to the red blood cells, and red blood cells remains into the body for 120 days, that is around 3 months, 2 to 3 months. So if a person has diabetes, it is reflected in their HbA1c values for a longer time. It gives a value of a longer time, 2-3 months duration. So it is more definitive to have glycated hemoglobin level determined if we want to know the blood sugar level of a particular patient. Now, coming to molecular diagnosis, we have several potential biomarkers of periodontitis present in saliva which can be identified, and these biomarkers are mainly certain molecules which are present in the inflammatory process or which signify the presence of the inflammatory process. So, markers of inflammation are beta-glucuronidase, C-reactive protein, interleukin 1 and 6, macrophage inflammatory protein 1 alpha, and the tumor necrosis factor. And these are markers of inflammation. Another one which is anti-inflammatory, that is interleukin 35, and their presence shows suppression of periodontal inflammation and maintenance of periodontal health. Next, we have markers of connective tissue breakdown. When these markers are present, it indicates that there is a breakdown of connective tissue at that area. Alpha 2 macroglobulin, then matrix metalloproteinases, they are mostly their significant increase is confirmed in the saliva of patients with periodontitis. Tissue inhibitors of metalloproteinases and alanine aminotransferase 11. Then we have markers of bone remodeling. These are alkaline phosphatase, C-terminal telopeptide, then RANKL and osteoprotegrin. But main problem with these type of markers is that they are available in a very low quantity, and also the salicylate biomarkers are not as efficient as the other biomarkers for the bone remodeling. These are the list of certain biomarkers with the examples and the cells it is secreted by. This is the list of gingival crevicular biomarkers and the function of these biomarkers. Now, coming to GCF biomarker in periodontal disease, we have superoxide dismutase 1, which is most important line of antioxidant enzyme defense system. Then apolipoprotein A1, which is a major component of high density lipoprotein, and dermicidin, which is antimicrobial function. Then we have annexin-1, cystatin B, defensins, which are mostly detected in healthy individuals, while L-clastin, actin bundling protein are expressed in leukocytes and play a crucial role in immune-mediated events. Coming to the recent trends we have in the diagnosis of periodontal disease, one is nanobiochips, where we integrate various laboratory procedures in a single cartridge, and it is also known as lab on a chip, where it utilizes a very small sample of saliva or blood products for the diagnosis process. Next, we have optical coherence tomography, which is a non-invasive method of imaging dental microstructure, which can potentially evaluate the health of periodontal tissue. And this method provides an optical biopsy of 2 to 3 mm deep in depth of tissue. And because OCT reveals microstructural detail of the periodontal soft tissue, it can potentially identify active periodontal disease before significant alveolar bone loss occurs. So, coming to conclusion, diagnosis is an important tag that a clinician ties on the disease condition of the patient, capturing all his past experience with the condition in question. So, most often an accurate diagnosis is the first concrete step towards the planning and execution of an appropriate individualized treatment plan, contributing significantly towards the success of the therapy. So, as a clinician, it is our duty to have a thorough knowledge about different investigations pertaining to our field of study. These are my references. Thank you all. I hope I was clear on this topic. Thank you and good luck.